Olá! A IUPAP, International Union for Pure and Applied Physics, está interessada em muitas coisas. Dentre elas, a definição das unidades básicas que nós usamos no dia a dia, a manutenção das constantes fundamentais, mas também está muito interessada nos desafios que a ciência tem atualmente. Na área da física são muitos os desafios. Nós temos desafios desde o entendimento das partículas elementares, da matéria condensada, na física nuclear, na biofísica, na astrofísica. Em todas as áreas ou sub-áreas da física, nós temos desafios. Para que você saiba quais são esses desafios, a IUPAP organizou um workshop especial, que chama-se Entendendo os Desafios da Física Moderna. Cada área da física está aqui sendo apresentada por um líder, membro da IUPAP, e que você terá então agora a chance de entender, através desta apresentação, os desafios que a área apresenta e como os físicos, de um modo geral, estão superando esses desafios, para que a física seja um instrumento de entendimento das ciências naturais e que auxilie o homem não apenas a avançar o seu conhecimento, mas a tornar a ciência um instrumento útil da melhoria de vida de cada um existente nesse planeta e nesse universo. Assista e também faça parte do entendimento dos desafios da física moderna. Boa sorte! And now we're going to move to the next talk, which is a 25-minute talk. And it's related to the Commission C8 Semiconductors. And will be presented by Belita Carli. She is a part of the Brazilian Physics Society and she's a member of the C8 Commission. So, Belita, please.
Thank you. It's very hard to talk about anything after this talk. I'll try to show you an overview of what's going on in semiconductor physics, not particularly about my work, so I may not be able to explain all the details of what I'm talking about. But I want to give some examples that illustrate the subject of this workshop, New Challenges in Pure and Applied Physics with respect to semiconductors. So I'll give a few examples, and the first example, the first thing I'll show is the topics that were presented in the ICPS 2016, the IUPAP Conference in Semiconductors, that was held last year in China. So I'll show very quickly the 16 topics that were picked as the state of the field. And what I did is I divided these 16 topics into groups, but because I'm going to say what's mature, what's going on, what's new, what's applied, what's basic science. So I will not read all this. I'll just show what in between those, what are the mature topics already. So material growth, structural properties and characterization for phonons is a mature field. Wide band gap semiconductor, narrow band gap semiconductors, transport insector structures like the Bloch oscillations, quantum Hall effects, electron devices, and applications. So these six topics are, I consider, mature, and I'm not going to talk about them. So there are other topics which are basic science that's becoming or became applications, new applications. So it's a transition from basic to applied science. And I would say material growth for nano devices, carbon nanotubes and graphene, for displays, organic semiconductors also for huge displays or flexible displays, transport indexer structure for electronic devices, quantum Hall effects now in metrology, electron devices and applications for miniaturization, and optical properties of optoelectronics solar cells for energy conservation. So these are still being developed. There are many devices for these purposes are still being devices and products. And finally, we have new basic science that maybe will be applied, maybe not. So this I include two-dimensional material before graphene, beyond graphene, spintronics and spin phenomena, quantum optics and nanophotonics, quantum information, and Majorana fermions in solid state. So I prepared a presentation about those with the stars because I think this will go to the optics group. But maybe I don't have time, so when I see the card chart saying I'm done, I can stop any point here. So a very big interest now is in 2D materials and van der Waals at their structures. And this is a review paper that appeared last year. The first author is one of the Nobel Prize winners for the discovery of graphene isolation. And Antonio Hélio Castro Neto is a Brazilian who is working with him and other people outside. And what happens is that, you know, probably know about graphene, this is what two-dimensional, one sheet, one monatomic layer of carbon. And now there are being synthesized many other two-dimensional materials. This is transition metal dicocosanoids, and this is to phosphorine, group 3 glycosanoid, boron nitride. So there are binary compounds, there is the phosphorus is just one element. And it's theoretically, it's been deeply studied in all detail. This is a density of states for the electrons or for phonons in these materials. And each one is being explored in terms of properties and applications like the graphene is. But the new idea, and this is also already being implemented, is that they can be stacked and intercalated one another, either mechanically like this, or by epitaxial growth of different materials on top of each other. And this way, we may it's being considered different functionalities of these materials, and on-demand properties also could be developed. This is underway. I don't know of any specific application already, but this is being fabricated, and it's compared to a Lego. It's like a Lego structure that's prepared artificially. So it's a multi-material, multi-layer, multi-material structure. And this is a real image of what they can do. And this is the dispersion relation. And here you see that there are already devices being developed using the properties of these materials. This is a characteristic curves of the response. And so there's a lot going on. And not only the stacked structures are being studied, also lateral two-dimensional heterostructures have been developed. And both of them, the lateral and the stacked structures, have potential to bring new physics, new phenomena, and new applications. The next topic I'm going to talk is spintronics and spin phenomena, where it's been proposed many years ago if transistors would be including the spin degrees of freedom, then the processing power of conventional electronics would be doubled, because then you have information carried by spin up and spin down electrons. So we need to control polarized electron current, and since the conventional devices are made of semiconductors, people already turned right away to magnetic semiconductors as possible carriers of polarized currents. So the electric control of magnetism also would be a possibility. So we need devices that work at room temperature. And until the 2005 or so, people only looked at manganese doping in 3-5 materials like gallium, manganese, arsenide. And manganese is an interstitial dopant, and it gives some. The magnetism is not a semiconductor, it's a dopant that has magnetic properties. And the maximum temperature that was obtained with this type of combination was 173 K, which is much below room temperature. And it's progressed very slowly. There was a limiting concentration of magnetism that would enter the 3,5 compound. So in last year, people changed completely the materials being involved. So instead of gallium arsenide, they did gallium antimonide doped with iron. And they could reach much higher temperature concentrations and much higher temperatures, which is room temperature. And this is a demonstration that the iron goes to substitutional. You keep the crystal structure zinc blend. And so this is a promising host for magnetic polarized currents. Another example is, again, a two-dimensional material, chromium iodine, and it's a 2D structure like this. There are three iodines for each chromium. And what happens is that this two-dimensional structure is ferromagnetic if you have a monolayer. But if you grow another layer on top, it becomes anti-ferromagnetic. Three layers ferromagnetic. So there's a lot of room to play here, and this is at room temperature. So it's a van der Waals crystal. I forgot to say the stacking is attractive to van der Waals interactions, which are very weak, but keep them together. And here also you can have van der Waals coupling between separate layers, and you get this rich magnetic behavior. And finally, I'm going to talk about the more recent topological insulators. It's a big topic in physics currently. And I just show a very simple reminder of what's a topological object. So the cup, you have a cup that has a handle with a hole, and you cannot get rid of the hole by deformating the cup. So you never start from a cup by deformation and end with a handless cup, because the hole is always there. And the same thing with the Möbius stripe. You don't get rid of the being one-sided by any continuous deformation. You cannot get a ring out of a Möbius stripe. So we say that the cup handle hole and the Möbius stripe are topologically protected against deformations. They will always keep the topology. Now, topological insulators are insulators in the bulk. The band, the conduction band is here, and the valence band is here for the bulk. So it's an insulator, has a big gap. So it's an insulator here. And if you apply a voltage, there will be current at the edges that are go one way for one spin direction and the other way for the other spin direction. So the up spin is always turning this way and the down spin is turning the other way. And the up and down spins, the currents contrapropagate. And the reason, the origin of these currents are not coming from the insulator band. They come from surface states that form at the surface. But now they really cross. They don't anti-cross like we saw in the previous talk. But they cross because they don't interact. And this is a positive velocity, so one side of velocity. This is positive momentum, negative momentum. And each one has a different spin. So the surface states are organized like that. And they are responsible for the currents. The spin momentum locking is a topologically protected quantity. And the most promising applications of topological insulators are in spin turning devices, because you not really get polarized currents in the system. Now I'm going to talk about quantum information. I think I'm going very fast. Quantum information in semiconductors. So there are many, There are many proposals to develop quantum bits in semiconductors. I show you a few. And I took those from a review paper from David Ashlom. This one, the first one, is on quantum dots. It's a two-dimensional electron gas in gallium arsenide, aluminum arsenide, where they put these gates that form attractive potentials that trap one or two electrons. And the electron's spin would be the quantum bit in this architecture. So you, they can manipulate. This is also fabricated with five quantum dots, and the gates operate the or control the electrons so that they can be two occupying the same site, and they interact. They perform quantum operations, or they stay in a site. This is the control of the quantum dots. Architecture, and you know, for a universal quantum computer, you just need to have one and two qubit operations. So semiconductor qubits are still in the one qubit, very few examples of two qubits. It's far from scalability. But this is one of the structures that's the early work on semiconductor quantum bits was in this architecture. This is another one that's a quantum dot, a self-assembled quantum dot, in an optical, in an photonic cavity. And the one qubit operations are performed in this electron, in this qubit. But the cavity, the photonic cavity, is to exchange photons between this quantum dot and a faraway quantum dot for the two qubit operations. And this is still a prototype. It's not operational. None of these are fully operational yet. This one, this artist's view of the silicon with dopant. This is a dopant, phosphorus dopant in silicon. And this dopant has a phosphorus has a spin. 10 minutes. OK, there's a spin of a donor in silicon. That's going to be manipulated by magnetic fields and interact with other donors. I'll come back to this later with more detail. But in principle, the one qubit operation would be run by ESR, and the two qubits by exchange between the two donors. And finally, there's a very promising system also that's diamond with defects. It's called NV centers, or nitrogen vacancy centers. And they have a very well-defined spin that has a long coherence time, and very, very sturdy, very robust single qubit operations here. But because they are so well, very bound, very tightly bound, the two qubit operation would be hard for this structure. So I come back to the some comments about fidelity. Of course, if you have a quantum evolution of a system, you want to desire some final state to represent the solution of your problem, but you get errors. So you obtain a state that's not the desired one, and you can quantify the fidelity of your computer by this scalar of product square. And you want it to be one, but because of errors, you have less than one, and we can identify the error by one minus f, how far you are from being the same state. The traditional error correction protocols involve more than 10, 12 ancilla qubits, and typically require an error less than 10 to the minus 4 or 10 to the minus 5 per qubit operation. So fidelities of this order are very hard to achieve in physical systems, not only in semiconductors. But there is a recent protocol, it's called surface codes, that are able to obtain fidelities above 99.9% with fidelities of this order. it already operates quantum bits, qubits, and achieves logical error rates which are significantly lower than the original error corrections. But the cost, this is a fragment of the surface structure that would perform these codes. And with this kind of error correction, you can have a fidelity of 0.99 is enough. And you see here, a good target for the gate fidelity is above about 99.9. In this case, a logical qubit will need to contain 10 to the 3 to 10 to the 4 physical qubits in order to achieve logical error rates below this limit. So the price you pay to have tolerance achievable experimentally is that a logical qubit will involve 1,000 or 10,000 qubits. So the structure becomes very big. And one proposal for the silicon quantum computer with phosphorus donors came out in this year, where they proposed the silicon. This is silicon with the donors here, phosphorus. And they put a gate here that polarizes the phosphorus, pushes the electron towards the surface, and forms an electric dipole. And you know electric dipole interactions are long range, 1/RT. So the 1 qubit operation would be control of this electron and nucleus structure. And for 2 qubits operations, you would have dipolar interaction between neighboring phosphorus. And this would be all in a superstructure that has connecting gates between one, this is 10 to the 3 to 10 to the 4 qubit phosphorus donors, and here more, and they interact via this line of, how do you say, line of transmission. So this is a pictorial view of what would be feasible for silicon quantum computing with donors, but in practice, this is the theory stage, theoretical stage, this would be a possible architecture. In practice, in the experiments, 1 qubit gates of this sort have already been implemented. But already in 2 qubit gates, with the polar cloud problem was not implemented yet. So this is too much to the future, and I don't know if semiconductors, they are promising hosts for qubits, but there are other systems that may be better. Nobody knows who's going to be the final. And finally, I'm going to talk about Majorana fermions in solid state, which is a very relatively new possibility of a new state of matter. And the fermion, Majorana fermion, was proposed in, I think, 1967. I'm wrong. So it was 8 years ago, and it was proposed by Majorana, who was a physicist. And he proposed there would be a particle that would be its own antiparticle. It has no charge, no mass, no spin. It's a very curious particle. But the main definition is that they are their own antiparticles. And they could one day help make quantum computers more robust because it's a topological particle. And it was produced in, it was proposed to live in a system that's hybrid between superconductors and semiconductors. So semiconductor nanowires, it was superimposed a cap, a cover with a superconductor. And this was done by Covenhoven and his group in 2012, and it is a one-dimensional nanowire made of semiconductor material with strong spin-orbit interaction. It was mentioned before, the spin-orbit interaction in semiconductors, and in the presence of in the presence of a magnetic field along the axis of the nanowire. The ingredient is to connect the semiconducting nanowire with an ordinary superconductor, and the proximity will form Cooper pairs in the semiconductor. So these Cooper pairs are going to dissociate, and they dissociate and go to the extreme of the edges of the quantum wire. And in the middle, it was predicted theoretically by the Sarma and another theorist, in the middle we get Majorana particles. So the current versus voltage would be something like peaks in the edges of the superconducting gap and a peak at zero voltage. And this was observed, maybe it's better to explain. So this is the DDV, the current versus voltage, and this is voltage. So the voltage, the current versus voltage, would have a the derivative would have a peak at the edges of the superconducting material, and in the middle, zero voltage, you get a peak, and this would be a signature of the Majorana particle. So it was predicted in particle physics, but it was observed in a semiconductor system. There were many discussions about the validity of this identification, but it was already, I'm done? Fine. Okay, so it was confirmed with more recent experiment that I didn't find yesterday to show you. So thank you.
No. We have time for one or two questions.
Yes.
Regarding quantum information, there's been a recent shift to go from MV center to silicon vacancy center. Do you like to comment on this?
Silicon vacancy?
Silicon vacancy instead of nitrogen vacancy.
Oh, in diamond.
Yes.
In diamond. No, I cannot comment, but maybe you can. Because.
No, I think from what I know about it is that in terms of phonons and controllability, as it turns out that silicon vacancy has some properties that the nitrogen vacancy could not offer. I think that's
maybe
the
it's less localized.
Yes.
So you can do two qubits operations. Okay, thank you.
Wait. Any other question?
When the Majorana fermions, the nanowire zero mode Majorana fermions came out, people joked that the trouble was that they were neither Majoranas nor fermions. And so what I'm wondering is, do you think that the progress that has been made since the original 2012 observations have put those kinds of criticisms to rest?
Well, I saw experiments of this type, of the same group, where they have much better defined peaks, and they are quantitatively in agreement with the theory. But unfortunately, I didn't find that. They are not published yet, but they have more convincing data that is according to the theory that was developed in Maryland. So I believe it is not another effect if it's a signature of Majorana.
Well, right. So it's not a random effect. It's a real effect. I guess the question is, people were criticizing it, saying, "Well, this really doesn't represent a fermion because, after all, it's an n-mode thing and it's a non-local phenomenon. It doesn't really represent something of the sort that Ettore Majorana would have thought of as being a Majorana fermion, and that it's not really a fermion either because."
Well, I know this is controversial. You said what people say. I hear a lot about it.
But
I hear,
I'm not an expert.
I see some results that are very convincing. Not those. They have new data, but it's not published yet. I saw from the authors.
But it's more convincing.
More convincing.
But of the same sort.
And it's more, because there are some things that even the people who did the theory did not agree.
Uh-huh.
And now at least they agree. I don't know what's going to be useful for, but it's fun.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's thank again Belita for the nice talk.